one at a time. This is factually untrue because the world of politics is not that black and white. However, what is absolutely true is that the lead member who works under the leader, of course, has wasted the year's extension that we were given and has still not done a proper job. The local plan working group that overviewed the process mysteriously stopped meeting a year ago, and there are no recorded meetings or minutes on the website since that time. Can the leader or leader please explain why this is the case? I am also most concerned that the recommendations written means that there will be no further debate for any ongoing scrutiny by anyone before the plan goes straight off to the inspector. We have been told that we must now throw in the towel and accept this plan because, contrary to the lead member's speech, the evidence base to reduce housing numbers is inadequate. However, it is just as important under duty to cooperate to consult with our neighbours and statutory bodies on many issues, including infrastructure, as it was to consult on housing numbers. For example, it appears that we have only just started the process of a meeting between RMW and Highways England, which took place on the 4th of April 2017, and I see no detailed plan setting out how we would resolve the highways issues identified so far, or how we would phase development to ensure an organised, structured and sustainable process to enable us to consult on. It is highly likely the inspector will find it unsound, for a number of reasons, not least consultation and duty to cooperate, which is the first thing he will look at, or she. The public accept that we need to provide more housing. They just don't believe that this plan is the way to do it, and I agree with them. Our local communities, who are developing our neighbourhood plans, have been offered funding by the Department of Communities and Local Government to pay for a technical support package which could unblock the conflict between the RMW local plan and the neighbourhood plans, which Council Dudley has blocked. The leader also said, if this isn't voted in on Monday, I will write to Sashi Javid, Secretary of State for Communities and Local Government, to come and take over. This is a scare tactic, as I have to check the legal, and whilst Council Dudley, like anybody, can write a personal letter to Mr. Jones, he does not have the authority to speak on behalf of the council on this matter. Why would the Department of Communities and Local Government be both financially supporting our neighbourhood planning groups to engage with us and at the same time want to take over the plan? That's not logical. The offer demonstrates that they would likely give us more time. And why would Council Dudley seek to take away the opportunity? This is a prime example of the leader's autocratic style. You can disagree with the leader, there are many consequences, but I'm going to do what I want anyway. Councillor Dudley, after stating publicly that this is a free vote tonight, also told residents that the Cabinet must vote collectively, supporting his position, presumably. He also made it quite clear to the Conservative group which way he expects them to vote. We have seen colleagues who have taken an opposing view to the leader in private, confidential, and what should be safe debating environment to be shouted at and dismissed from cabinet posts, panels and positions. And I can no longer support what has been going on since Councillor Dudley took over the leadership 13 months ago. Nor am I prepared any longer to be muzzled by the party group. I therefore say enough is enough. This has to stop. So it is with deep regret that I am forced to resign from the
Council.
And I will now continue to say serve my residents who voted for me as an independent Conservative.
Thank you.